Hello and welcome to the Trash Talk Podcast. I'm your host, JJ, and today I have Sergey.
Hello.
We're doing the thing again that we did like 2 weeks ago. We're talking about things that we don't know about, but the other one knows about, and then we're guessing what it's about. Because that made sense. So we're taking pieces of media that one of us has consumed, and hopefully the other has not. And then the other, in that case, would be guessing what that piece of media is all about. And we have posters, because that's really the easiest way to do it. Because I felt like just the title is not quite that much, and This seemed to be the perfect amount of information, because once you actually read the synopsis, it's like, what am I supposed to guess at this point? Do you want to go first? Because I went first last time. How about that?
Sure.
What do you want to talk about first?
So am I guessing for... okay, no. How about... Maybe the easiest one, the Ancient Magus Bride.
Alright, let me see which button am I pressing. This button I'm pressing. I swear I've done this before. I'm gonna say this is, first of all, it's obviously an anime. It is...
I'm quite a weeb, you see.
Yes. It is about the bride of an ancient magus, potentially, possibly, maybe.
How would you come to that conclusion?
I would even go so far as to maybe suspect that those two characters are, in fact, on the right side, the bride, and on the left side, the magus. Maybe.
Mm.
This seems to be the first volume or season or whatever, based on the fact that that's not even the point. But there's a number one in the corner. Over what I believe is a Celtic knot, but that I don't think that matters really. I'm gonna say... I would like to see her from the front, but I'm just gonna guess that... given that it's anime, she's probably a high schooler. That could be a school uniform what she's wearing. I don't know if it is for certain, but I'm just gonna go with that because... You know, it's anime, it's gonna be weirdly creepy about children.
Definitely. Can't even deny that.
Also, she looks really short if you consider that it looks like almost, like, more like he's sitting down. Which would further support the idea that maybe she's, in fact, suspiciously young. I don't know, what am I supposed to guess beyond the more obvious elements that I've said? Like, is...
I don't know.
Like, let me guess, this is a really weird relationship. She is married to him because of some sort of magical contract, and they're playing it mostly for jokes? That, I don't know.
Kinda, sorta, the thing is, the manga, or also the anime, just has this scene, like, once, where the Magus mentions that he kinda... Okay, wait. So, slight spoiler for the manga readers, or like no spoiler at all for the anime watchers. Chise, the girl, sold herself at an auction.
As you
for
do.
Reasons. Yeah. This Magus bought her and like mentioned like one single time that he wants to make her his bride. Like the anime or like the manga story, whatever. Like just never goes to that point. Like at all. Just doesn't matter.
Well.
Yeah.
Okay, that is good, I guess. Just for clarification, how old is she?
15 years old.
I fucking knew it. Japan,
yes.
Jesus.
Yes. Interesting thing though is this whole story, except for like the very beginning and like a few short segments, play in England. not in Japan, which is kind of unusual for
okay
anime and stuff.
Yes. That doesn't really disprove my point that the Japanese people are the ones that are creepy because they wrote it, but yes, the Japanese people as large wrote that.
But like the general thing about this is that it picks up on all kinds of fairy tales and incorporates them into the story. Okay. So it's couldn't name you any specific one, not because there aren't any, but because I'm just lacking general knowledge on pretty much all of them. As is usually the case with me.
And general knowledge, yeah.
It is pretty cool. There doesn't happen anything really in there. So like no real action sequences or anything of that sort. Just like a slow... I don't know, the show is just generally pretty slow. But kind of makes you feel good, I guess.
Okay. From, you know, Sergei feeling good about pedophilia to the next. I'm sure that's what we got from that. To my first entry on this list, I don't know if you know anything about this one. Just for full disclosure, I have not told Sergei any of my choices, but I have enough to have backups just in case.
Yeah.
Do you know anything about, or would you want to guess what a person of interest is about?
Probably some kind of Jason Bourne type of movie, maybe TV series.
Okay, so it is a TV series. I'm going to tell you that much, but
I don't know what it is.
So. Is that all you got in terms of guessing, or do you want to maybe get something else? I don't know. This poster does show a little bit of something relevant, but...
I don't know. Seems like some sort of hitman detective kind of thing going on, maybe with weapons. I can't really make it out.
I'm pretty sure it looks like he has a very large weapon.
The image was pretty small on my end.
Okay.
Yeah. It does look like a weapon.
Yeah.
Looks like there's some sort of I already started from getting words.
Yes, we're doing good. Same issue as last time.
Surveillance. Surveillance of the public going on.
That is a very important aspect that you just picked up on.
Yeah. So assume they are trying to track a person of interest through the surveillance system, but are failing to do so, and that's what the story is about, them trying to find that guy.
First of all, it's very presumptuous of you to think that the person of interest would be a guy. and second of all, on a more serious note, ironically enough, this show is not at all about catching one specific person in particular. The basic premise with which it starts is that they have a system that can basically predict the future using data from surveillance and whatnot, but all the information that they're getting is they know someone's going to get murdered, and they get a social security number, and that is somehow connected to that. It's usually the victim or the killer. And so they have to then figure out how the murder is going to happen, or how, not necessarily murder, but like how, it's usually like murder or something like that, it's usually somewhat intentional, how the homicide is going to occur, and their whole shtick is trying to then prevent that. So.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
And then every episode is basically a new case. So the person of interest is basically like they get a social security number, so they now know they're looking for someone, and then that is effectively what the personal interest is for that episode. There's a little bit more of an overarching story that comes into it, and it gets a little bit wilder towards the end, but I don't want to necessarily go into details. What I can say is that I would highly recommend it. I think it's a really good show.
I think we've talked about this before, because I remember mentioning it's pretty similar to Minority Report. And you...
In some ways, yes. So this is literally just like a really small team, and they're like not officially working for the government. So they are working with the police to some degree, but more so informally. So it's a little bit different in that regard.
Okay.
And their main thing is more so trying to protect people rather than trying to arrest people before they can commit a crime. Though, of course, I'm pretty sure people do get arrested when they're like, you know, literally about to kill someone and they get caught like basically in the act without actually ending up killing someone. Again, the broader details of the show I don't even want to go and get into because it's slowly revealed over the course of the show and it's actually very interesting. I'm pretty sure you could still watch it if you knew the details.
That does sound pretty interesting.
What is your second, well, anime?
Let's
or is one of those
go
actually
with
just a manga or a novel or something?
They all wait. No, I'm actually not sure. Anyway, I'm gonna go with Ajin.
That is the one where I have no idea if there is an anime or not.
It does have an anime. Two seasons.
Then they all do. The problem is, you say Ajin, and I say I don't know what that means. So all I have to go off is the additional text that is on here, which I'm pretty sure is just a bunch of names, and then it says demi-human. Demi is, I believe, Greek, meaning half. And I also see this weird skeletal mummy creature, which is weird because it looks like it's just... It might just be bandages, but it is vaguely skeleton-shaped, which is fascinating.
Kind of is. Also, Ajin, I think, translates to demi-human, so...
Great! I'm gonna go with... This is the story... of someone coming back from the dead wrong and I also want to say horror based on I'm gonna go with this is a horror story about something undead and maybe our protagonists are trying to stop it. I was tempted to go with, like, the guy on the cover is the protagonist and something like that, which, you know, knowing anime is very likely, but I'm going to go with they're trying to stop him. I'm going to say he's the antagonist.
You're pretty close to the undead kind of thing. So, Ajin are not the things... Not the thing on the cover.
Okay.
They're normal humans, but they have one little thing about them, and that is that they can't die. They are immortal.
That is a very important minor trait to have.
So, and an additional thing is they can summon these things. I forgot what they're called. Because it's been a long time since I've seen this. And by these things, I mean the thing on the cover image. The protagonist is a 17 years... No, wait, no, that's a different thing. Actually, I don't know how old the main character is. Anyway, he's like a high schooler, obviously, as Japan does.
I mean, to be fair, high school protagonists are not that uncommon in any kind of... It's oftentimes if the target audience is like that age, you know, like young adult media, you oftentimes have high schoolers. And it's funny because oftentimes you'll have like book series about like middle schoolers or high schoolers, and then they when this gets adapted, they'll get aged up to high schoolers or college students.
Yeah, because it's kind of weird if they're younger than that.
I mean, it depends, but depending on what the storylines are about, especially if they're leading us to certain directions, it definitely is always better to be like, you know, let's just make sure everyone's adult here. There have been...
Or at least close to.
...works adapted with younger children as the protagonists. But it's also always tricky because then you have to get good child actors, and, you know, and especially historically, those are few and far between.
But yeah, our protagonist one day finds out that he is one of those immortal humans when on the way to, I think, to school, is overrun by a car and doesn't die, surprisingly.
Yeah, that would kill you. Oh, could kill you. I mean, it really depends on the exact details, but yeah.
Yeah, and that then everything in his life is kind of destroyed by the police and like pretty much everything trying to chase him down, because in this world, these immortal humans are seen as a major threat to humanity.
Because of course they are.
Yes. And it's not the fun type of immortality.
Ooh, I don't like the unfun kind of immortality.
Yes, and the show does go into details on these unfun things that can happen to you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I kind of like it when immortality is treated as the sort of thing that has like a lot of downsides, and I've seen various interpretations of that, but some of those are actually really interesting. I can recommend you a show that also deals very much with the concept of immortality in various types, that a lot of which end up having at least some negative aspects to them. And that show is called Torchwood. You might have heard of it. How far have you seen Torchwood, Sergei?
I think 3 or 4 episodes, I'm not sure.
I know, it's like we talked about this like a couple months back and you were just as far in as like...
Yep. I haven't watched a single episode since. I really should.
Mm-hmm. That's the other problem with me recommending you shows. It's like, oh yeah, let's recommend another show. Like, oh yeah, Person of Interest is great. You should watch. It's like, well, also you should probably just finish watching Torchwood at some point, though. Jesus.
I'm going to write myself a list right now. At least start one.
Yeah. It's a fun thing to do, yeah. Like, you write a list and all of a sudden you realize that it's, like, 3,000 episodes in total and it's gonna take you, like, forever.
Yeah.
You remember how, like, a couple episodes back I talked about, like, all the shows that I still want to watch, and I also made a loose list and I went to, like, episode count and then, like, average duration of episode as I found it on IMDb and blah, 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 and I ended up getting close to 3,000 hours and I'm like, ooh, yeah, so about that.
That's a lot of hours.
That's a lot of hours, yes.
How many days of, like, 8 hours a day watching that I can easily...
The answer is multiple years, Sergey. The answer is multiple years. I think.
If you watch, like, 8 hours a day...
8 hours
a day
is doable, but that is, like, you know, without pausing...
It's, like, slightly over a year.
Yeah. It's about a year. But I think I did a calculation once where I was like, oh yeah, like, I don't know, like 4 to 6 hours or something. It's like, yeah, that's not even, like, I've accepted
that's like
not,
2 years.
Not like a,
yeah.
And like, let's not forget that there's also like new stuff airing at times.
Oh, totally.
And I'm also like, I literally, today, as of recording today, I've watched 4 different episodes, like new episodes of shows that have come out today. It's like,
damn.
Then also getting through those other shows that I was gonna watch, like, yeah.
Hey, that reminds me, I still have to watch the new episode of The Book of Boba Fett.
Oh, you have not watched the new episode of The Book of Boba Fett then, huh? See, I already watched that yesterday, Sergey.
Yeah.
That was one of the three episodes I watched yesterday in terms of new things. Because I keep up with a lot of shows. yeah, that one was actually not too bad. It didn't do that much, but... Yeah. I still think episode 2, I think, was the best one thus far, but that is besides the point!
How about...
Honestly, I think we're going to do one more, and then we're probably going to keep the other ones for another time, because we've already been going for... Oh, why?
Sure.
It's okay! Okay, I might have talked about this one before. If you remember it, I'm just going to go to the next one, but what do you think The Man from Earth is about?
I don't think I know this, and I don't think we talked about this, but could very well be the case.
I definitely remember...
Because
this is one of those that I like to talk about sometimes. I'm pretty sure we did a similar thing about guessing stuff at one point where I had... I don't remember exactly the circumstances, but I did bring it up on the podcast to Alex before, but I thought I might have mentioned it before because I do... Actually, this one I also recommend, and it's a movie, so you can actually watch it in a timely fashion.
Oh. That means I'm going to watch it after this podcast.
Oh.
Maybe, if we finish early enough, because my sleep schedule is... really, really good right now. It has been for like last like 2 weeks.
How? That is a very long time
for anyway, you. Beside the point.
What is The Man from Earth really about?
So from the cover image, it looks like some random human got transported to like an alien world or something through a rift in the space-time continuum. Or whatever, and like, I don't know, interacts with aliens and learns alien ways of life and like teaches aliens human ways of life, I guess, and tries to come back.
I love how just from the title you think aliens, right? And then they made this the poster, yep. And it just feels so much more like it's about aliens, despite the fact that it has nothing to do with aliens. which is really funny. So the basic premise is this is the story of a guy named John, and he specifically goes by John Oldman, which is very funny, you see, because he is actually, and this is very fitting to what we talked about before, an immortal.
Damn.
He's a really old man, you see. but he's a good kind of immortal.
Nice.
He has lived for a very long time, and the movie is basically just him telling his story to some of his colleagues. That's the movie.
Oh.
It's almost entirely set within one
movie.
That sounds
kind of fun.
And it's actually really good.
Nice. That does sound pretty cool.
And apparently there's a sequel, and apparently it sucks. I have not seen the sequel. But it's supposed to not really live up to the original. That being said, yeah, The Man from Earth is a really interesting movie. Again, it ends up being relatively simple in as far as it just basically having like one set that is filmed on. And I do recommend it though. Which brings us, I think, to the facts. Yeah, that's how we do this.
Right. Yes, facts. So have you heard of the Sony rootkit scandal of 2005?
I have not, but I actually know what all of these words mean, so I feel like I'm already ahead of most people.
Yeah, so Sony is a company that is very big.
I think the main thing is that most people probably don't know what a rootkit is.
Yeah, so rootkit is a type of software that hides itself on the computer and allows access to the whole or parts of the operating system.
Yes.
That it is on. So, apparently, Sony, back in 2005, decided to distribute a rootkit on their music CDs that would prevent users from copying the files of the CDs, obviously.
I should have known it was about copy protection, because of course it's about copy protection.
Yes,
most
obviously.
Most rootkits are, weirdly enough, despite the fact that it's supposed to be a hacking thing.
So they produced 22 million CDs with the rootkits on them.
Oh yeah, there's not that much
yes.
to think about it, but yeah.
They had two different versions of the rootkit on there at different times. One of them would install after the user accepted the EULA. Software wasn't actually not listed in the EULA, so that I don't know. And the other one would just install as soon as the EULA screen was displayed. So it was.
That can't be legal.
It did not matter if the user agreed to this or not. The software wasn't even part of the EULA at all.
Okay.
So it was completely independent.
Okay, but you could have always added like a vague clause where it's like, oh yeah, we by the way have the right to do anything in it and we want to your computer. And it's like, I guess you do.
Yeah, no. So, it was relatively hard to, first of all, find the software and then remove it from the computers, because it most likely exploited some zero-day exploits to even be able to install secretly without the user's consent or knowledge on the system. But it also introduced some vulnerabilities of its own, which other malware programs based their attack vector on.
Which is also far from unheard of, yeah.
Yep. Yeah. And the funny thing is, like, the main objective of this program was to protect copyright, right?
As it always is, yes.
They used parts of copyleft open source code illegitimately against the license, thus committing copyright infringement.
Oh, I gotta love it. I mean, there was a scandal some blowback about a video game which basically also installed rootkit as part of its.
Oh.
I think it's something. I think it was anti-piracy, but it might have also been anti-cheat. It might have been both. I don't remember. But like, and yeah, people were also not exactly happy about that. Also, it's always fun when video games come with that sort of stuff, and then they run a lot better without it. It's always a good one. So especially when they don't actually want to install a rootkit on your computer, so they basically run a virtual system within which the game then plays. They're not really a full-blown OS, but like. Basically, it runs inside of a virtualization,
yeah.
And then if you actually don't run it virtualized without the protective measures, it actually runs a lot better. People have pointed out that a lot of copyright protection measures, sort of technologically ones like that, oftentimes make the experience for the paying users a lot worse, while they only mildly deter piracy by usually just delaying until something's pirated, which effectively ends up hurting the legitimate users more than the pirates, in turn driving more people to piracy. So, you know.
Yeah, always something worth considering. Kind of crazy.
Also,
anyway,
I have heard that piracy actually has the nice effect of sometimes helping boost sales for things because of word of mouth. I don't know how well that works for like larger things, but I've heard for like smaller, like for like indie games and such, like some of the creators are actually really, to some degree, like piracy. Now, of course, they wouldn't. Most of them probably wouldn't publicly encourage it, but they much rather you pirate
that,
the game.
That kind of reminds me.
And then tell people about how
that
the
reminds
game
me.
Then to not pirate it.
Yeah. I think the game is called Game Maker Tycoon or something like that. Game Dev Tycoon.
Oh, yeah, I've heard of it. Yeah.
Where they themselves released a pirated version of the game. The game being about developing video games.
Yeah.
And the pirated version that they distributed, they added some aspect to the game being pirated games. Their games being pirated, which drove the company in the game bankrupt over time, which was fun.
Yeah, I mean, there's been a lot of those where anti-piracy measures were also like, oh yeah, we know you're going to crack the game, but if you do and you're not careful, it'll just be unplayable. Those are always fun.
Yeah.
So did you have anything else about your fact? So.
Yes, I do. So Sony later released an uninstaller, and that word is actually in quotations on Wikipedia, which kind of surprised me.
You know, you fucked up when even Wikipedia
and
starts
tells
bringing
you,
out the quotation marks.
Yes. that only unhides the program, the rootkit, but installs additional software that could not easily be removed, and introduces even more security vulnerabilities, and collects your email address.
Because of course!
Yes. Fun.
Yes. My fact of the week is also kind of fun.
Oh, damn.
So, have you heard of the country Ukraine that, at least as of recording, still exists?
Yeah.
So, they have a Twitter account, which is not that unusual for a country to have a Twitter account.
Yes, it loves to shitpost.
And yeah,
few...
I was about to say, like, they every now and again they just post memes. Usually, at least lately, about the very obvious conflict that they currently have with Russia. Stop saying Ukraine crisis, there's no crisis, there's a bad neighbor. like, there's a lot of actual, like, posts about, like, you know, Ukraine history and whatnot, but then, it's a meme, right? Putin's real fears. It's not Ukraine, the NATO, it's human rights, free press, and fair elections. just like, oh yeah, like, here's some pictures of Ukraine, Ukrainian people, and Ukrainian history, and then there's, like, oh yeah, types of headaches, and it's like, oh yeah, living next to Russia. It's like,
yep.
Samples of when the piece didn't actually work. Your search did not match any documents. Like, it's just.
Yep.
There's also one. Yeah, there's another one. And I think there's one where they even responded directly to Russia. They were, like, quote tweeting something that the Russian Twitter account had posted about Crimea. And they were like, am I going to find it right away? Probably not. Oh, yeah, there it is. At Russia posted, blah, blah, blah. A new work of art has graced the shores of Russia's Crimea. And then Ukraine before and after the tweet, and it's the same map. And I'm pretty sure Crimea is this bit, which is still very much listed as part of the Ukraine, because some might say that Russia has illegally occupied it. I believe the official UN stance is that it's part of Russia again, but let's not talk about it. Because
I don't know. Politics. But yeah, when I first saw the Twitter account and some of the posts, I did not think it is legit.
I was like,
I spent like an hour researching if this is actually the real one.
I was like, okay, so that is surprising. I mean, like, okay, it's called Ukraine, it's at Ukraine, it says the official Twitter account of Ukraine, and it has a blue checkmark, right? So You would expect it to be.
It is verified.
I'm like, yeah, it can't be right. Like, people have been able to get verified as other people before. It's not unheard of.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I googled it too, but like, yeah, no, this is for real. This is the actual official Twitter account of the country Ukraine. And yes, they're shitposting about the fact that Russia is trying to invade them. Which, you know.
Priorities, I guess.
Halftime show! Language guessing!
Yeah!
One too hard. We've done a medium.
Google Maps already pulled up. Let's try hard. Let's see how quick we fail.
Well, I mean, you might be able to recognize Polish.
Beata Szydło
desygnowana na premiera. That might be Polish.
That sounds Polish. I cannot read what the middle one is. Because the bitrate is kind of wonky.
Amharic.
For me. Amharic.
Amharic? I'm pretty sure it's Amharic. But yeah, I mean, I was going to go with Polish. I can play it again a little bit longer if you want, but...
Yeah, no. It sounds like Polish to me.
It was Polish.
Hi, Somali, and...
si fa fa hena usi wait si dwaytoy ko badi hin housing ka dibaato arkan qaar arimo ku saabsan dibaato arkan families ka qaar ka problem ha haysta dhalinyarada youth ka problem xoog leh dhinaca ay yaani inay crime sameeyaan way badi hin like had that specific question at deep no si wait maybe in an yaani
I mean I'm tempted to go with Somali so the options are Thai which
yeah
I would expect for somewhere Asian Somali which mm-hmm. this could very well be, and Esperanto, which is a little bit difficult to get based on the accent, because people do pronounce it differently at times. So Esperanto is an international auxiliary language designed by L.L. Zamenhof about 100 years ago. Might have been longer even.
Oh.
I don't know, I think it was about 100 years ago.
Interesting.
So,
constructed language.
Yes, it is a constructed language, and it is, I believe, the single most widely spoken constructed language in the world. I think there's about 1,000 native speakers. There is at least even one second-generation native speaker. Because one native speaker had kids, and also raised him with Esperanto. That being said, it
so, like, basically, there is...
vocabulary from European languages. No. So, if it's Esperanto...
Mm-hmm.
In theory, we should be able to at least somewhat get what they're saying. And I did hear like one or two words. It probably shouldn't sound like that. But again, it might vary from speaker to speaker a little bit. Though there are technically official pronunciation guidelines, but some liberties have been taken with it at times. Also, I think they weren't using the IPA back then, so it's not even 100% clear how things are supposed to be pronounced.
Oh.
Sometimes. Yeah, IPA, by the way, in this case, standing for the International Phonetic Alphabet, and not for the International Phonetics Association, which invented it, which has the same acronym, because I guess they're bad at acronyms. So I think we're going to go with Somali. Right?
I'm going to go with Somali, because Esperanto seems hard to judge.
I mean, Esperanto is very heavily pulling vocabulary from Romance languages, but also from Germanic languages, so... I feel like I should be able to understand at least a decent amount of Esperanto.
Estradegin ortin zuun sayas toosh deesh dollarin khorin gurult geyvel geregin ik urul batalna gech giisen baag. Tege sai en erdentii yum inged erged ukhchasan chin. Ter nugo bi yamar bukh khumiig zal sooja kha yun boltsa baikh bish. Ter gul tuvjegin bultalaach chigsen. Ter gul tuvjegin bultalaach chigsen.
So that was weird. Macedonian, Mongolian, or Javanese? I assume Javanese is spoken on Java, which is in Indonesia. I think it's the biggest island in Indonesia, where most of the people live. I think we had Mongolian before, and I want to say we've had something like this being Mongolian. I want to say Mongolian.
Yeah, I would lean into Mongolian too.
Yes! It's Mongolian! Hey! Well, see, we're not doing so bad, despite the fact that it's hard.
Yeah.
Oh boy. We have Somali again as an option, and Polish again as an option, and then there's Hungarian, which is a Finno-Ugric language, which we've talked about before.
Gorcsev Iván, a Rangún teherhajó matróza még 21 éves sem volt, midőn elnyerte a fizikai Nobel-díjat.
Is that Polish?
Can you play that again?
Gorcsev Iván, a Rangún teherhajó matróza még 21 éves sem volt, midőn elnyerte a fizikai Nobel-díjat. Ilyen nagy jelentőségű tudományos jutalmat e politikusan ifjú korban megszerezni példátlan nagyszerű teljesítmény. Még a...
There's some pronunciation elements that make me think a little bit Slavic, but I don't... It doesn't also not feel that Slavic to me, so it might just be that...
It does not feel Polish. I'm leaning into Hungarian.
Yeah, I was going to say maybe it's Hungarian and then the pronunciation sounds a little bit Slavic because they're like in the general area of the world.
Yeah.
And it is Hungarian. Hey... Korean, Kurdish, or Samoan? Huh.
매주 금요일 데일리 오버뷰에서는 한 주의 중요한
I was gonna go with Korean.
Mm-hmm. I would agree.
Oh, yikes. Actually, maybe not so yikes. Catalan.
This sounds doable.
French, Swedish, and Hausa. I mean, Swedish, French, and Catalan, we should be, I mean, by process of elimination, we should also be applicant Hausa then.
Sjön också, det är ju mycket, jag tänker på båtolyckor, det är ju mycket alkohol med i bilden när det gäller båtolyckor i Sverige. Men vad jag har förstått så har det gått neråt. Och jag har förstått sen den här sommaren, många börjar beskriva att den här blir en historiskt fantastiskt bra sommar. Men det har väl konsekvenser med sig också.
I was gonna go with Swedish actually.
Yeah, where's Hausa spoken again?
Hausa is spoken in Africa. I don't know exactly where, but I think it's sub-Saharan Africa. Somewhere down there.
Yeah, Swedish.
And Swedish is a Germanic
like
language.
Germanic
and I feel like
language.
I understood some words. So,
yeah.
I mean, I would have also understood some words if it was French, but and also Catalan because it's closely related to French, despite the fact that I think Catalan is descended from the Languedoc and not the Languedoy, but that's a whole other thing. What? What in the world is Canada? Is it one of the Inuit languages? Because that's where they
maybe.
Live. Is that what the country is named after, or is the language named after the country? Okay.
So what I can make out is Norwegian, Luxembourgish, Canada, and Odia.
I guess. I honestly. I think this might be the first time where I cannot tell you anything about a language. I don't know where that is. I mean, if I had to guess based on the fact that I don't know where it is, it might very well be in Africa because it's one of the most linguistically diverse places in the world. But that doesn't necessarily mean it has to be there. Luxembourgish is very close to German. Norwegian is not as close, but...
ಆಸ್ಟ್ರೇಲಿಯಾದಲ್ಲಿ ಬೆಳೆದ ಸಂಸ್ಥಾನದ ರಾಜತಂತ್ರಜ್ಞ ಅವರೊಬ್ಬರನ್ನು ಈ ವಾರ ತನ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಪುನರಾರಂಭಗೊಳ್ಳಲಿರುವ ಮಧ್ಯಪ್ರಾಚ್ಯ ಶಾಂತಿ ಮಾತುಕತೆಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಮುಖ್ಯ ಸಂಧಾನಕಾರರನ್ನಾಗಿ ನೇಮಿಸಲಾಗಿದೆ. ವರ್ಷ 2010ರ
I don't think listening to more of this will help us because I have no idea about Odia or Canada, but I sound Luxembourgish and I'm pretty sure it's not Norwegian.
Yeah.
Actually, I think Luxembourgish is closer related to German. I actually come to think of it, not 100% certain, but I'm pretty sure it is. But yeah, no, Luxembourgish is... Yeah, no, that's like... No, it's not like German. It has some French influences. No, I do know what that is like. Wait, anyways. Which one of those do we want to go with? I'm tempting towards Odia because I know nothing about that, and the other one I would at least associate with Canada, and I'm not sure if I have heard the Inuit languages necessarily, but I feel like they wouldn't sound like that.
Canada doesn't sound like a name... to give to the language, at least from the sounds of it, like.
Oh yeah. I get what you're saying. It doesn't sound like that word would be part of the language that we just heard.
Yeah.
Yet it is.
Oh, okay. Well,
that could be the problem. If it is one of the languages that's natively spoken there, then they named the country maybe, and then afterwards, because a lot of languages don't have a word for the language. Now, oftentimes it is then just derived from their word for, like, language you're speaking or something like that. But it could just then be derived from the location. But like, oh yeah, they were in Canada, they speak Canada. I don't know. I'm really just guessing. I didn't know anything about either of those languages. I do know a lot of stuff about some of these languages, though. Yiddish being a lot like German, with some Hebrew influences. Spanish being the language of Spain, and also of, like, most of South America and Central America and Mexico, which is North America. Latin is the language that Spanish is derived from. And Burmese is the language of Burma. I don't know anything about that, but it's the language of Burma. That's good.
Where's Burma?
You always gotta ask these questions, man. Could you just not ask it?
Please.
I'm pretty sure I've seen that before.
Geographical location helps me determine.
I genuinely don't know right now, man. It's not very big, I think. I also think they changed their name at some point. Burma. But I might be wrong about that. I'm gonna play this while you look
it up. It's next to Thailand.
Oh, yeah, so... Did you just say Thailand?
Yes.
It's Thailand.
Nah.
Sid Bäume ist erfahrgenegen, du bist da und du wirst vorstellen von unserer Eure.
That was Yiddish. Because it just sounds like accent in German. And I am a native speaker of German. Okay. Oh, our favorite is coming back, Sergey. We've got Canada again. There's also Japanese, which you should be able to recognize. I mean, I would probably recognize it too, given the options. Slovak, which I believe is a Slavic language. And Faroese, which I still don't know about, but it's presumably spoken in the Faroe Islands, which are... Oh, fuck, I recently heard about this. It's... I want to say it's part of Norway. No, sweet. I don't know. It should be North Germanic, at least geographically speaking, so it's probably... Also linguistically speaking.
Yeah.
Nummer 2. Ondjunska vara nøddir av ralimer vi fela. Einutjunta grein. Nummer 1. Ötla var rattla taka lot ur stjötn landsyns, anna kvar spainleis...
I think it's Faroese, right?
By process of elimination, yeah.
I thought I could, like... I thought he said, like number one, blah, blah, blah. Like, I thought I could, like, vaguely understand what he was saying, so it's probably a Germanic language. Well, I mean, the fact that I understand it does not immediately make it a Germanic language, since I also speak a Romance language, but given that I understood it, I could then group it. Oh, hey, this one should be not too difficult.
Should be easy.
Wait, what is Bulgarian like, anyways? Because that could be tricky.
I don't know.
If that's a Slavic language...
Process of elimination should...
Well, yeah, but Ukrainian, Bulgarian. I don't know. I mean, Italian, German.
I feel like I should be understand. I should understand more Ukrainian than I would Bulgarian.
That might be the case.
І беручи до уваги, що народи об'єднаних націй підтвердили в статуті свою віру в основні права людини, в гідність і цінність людської особи, і в
That sounds Ukrainian.
And it is Ukrainian. I mean, I know it was Slavic. But again, I don't know anything about Bulgarian, so it could be a Slavic language. Geographically, that would not be too far-fetched. So I needed you to help me with that one. Farsi, Mongolian, Khmer, and Swedish. Khmer. Where's Khmer spoken? Mongolian spoken in Mongolia, we've had that before. Farsi is Persian that is spoken in Iran. Swedish is spoken, believe it or not, in Sweden mostly.
Det är väldigt intressant, för jag tänkte på det här också. Alltså, en sån individ som Raoul Wallenberg och vad han...
That is Swedish, isn't it?
That sounds Swedish.
And now we have 5 options. Also, by the way, 5 options, I'm pretty sure we didn't always get to, so we're already doing at least as good as we did on Medium, and we've only made one mistake thus far. Afrikaans is a language spoken in South Africa, which is derived from Dutch.
That's important information.
It's surprisingly hard to understand, but it shouldn't be any more difficult than something like Swedish. So, Czech, I believe, is a Slavic language. I'm not 100% sure. Turkish, I believe, is a Turkish language.
Kind of, sort of, similar to Poland. Polish.
Kurdish, I don't know anything about, but given the location, I would assume it's related to either Arabic or Turkish. Catalan is... spoken in the Catalonia region of Spain, as well as Andorra and a little bit of France in that area where Port is at. So
Yeah.
It's a mix between, some people say it's a mix between Spanish and French. I think it's more closely related to Spanish, but it has very clear French influences. Should be doable.
Okay, that this might be hard.
Právo volně se pohybovat a svobodně si volit bydliště uvnitř určitého.
Check? Are we saying check?
That sounds check. Yeah, yeah. That.
Okay, Russian. We have a native speaker in the house. That should be easy. Assyrian. Okay, Hebrew. That's a Semitic language spoken mostly in Israel. Canada, presumably a native language of Canada. We don't know that. Tamil, I believe, is spoken in India, as well as it's being one of the four official languages of Singapore. Which is, like, close to India, so it makes sense that it would have spread there. I think it's spoken in southern India specifically, and I think the reason why it's official in Singapore is because a lot of workers from southern India went there to get work, and then they stayed there. I think that's why that was. Singapore is a very fascinating situation with the official languages. There are four official languages, as I mentioned before: English, Mandarin, Tamil, and one that I should probably not forget, but I do right now.
I think you did last time too.
Yeah, I know.
وقت دبيت بأورا زد قواليات أغورة ومارد ملكانا أها إلخ خرزة دي لنايا.
I don't know about Assyrian, but I'm tempted towards Hebrew.
Somewhat.
I mean,
still not sure.
I can play it again.
Yeah.
بيت بأغرا زد قواليات أغورة ومارد ملكانا أها إلخ خرزة دي لنايا.
Yeah.
The ha 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 sort of stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
I very heavily associate with Semitic languages, but I don't know where Assyrian belongs to, and I think it could be in that vague region, so it could also be Assyrian, but.
It was! Hey!
I mean, at least I was saying it's one of those two,
yeah.
And it was one of those two, I just clicked the wrong one. It could have been much worse, but of course, for practical purposes, it doesn't make a difference. Thai, Turkish, Malay, which is spoken in Malay. Wait, is it? Was that? No, I'm not sure. Anyways, Malay, which is spoken in Malaysia. Turkish, which is spoken in Turkey. German, we know. Lao, which I guess is the official language of Laos? I don't know. That's just a guess. But given the name, that is the best I can come up with. There's a lot of unknowns in there.
สบายดีท่านจำรัดขอให้ท่านรายงานข่าวให้ทราบได้ว่าอยู่แถวอุดรจับได้แก๊ง5คนที่ว่าลักรถจักรอันนี้มันเป็นอะไรเนาะก็แปลว่าพวกนี้มันบ่ได้ไปลักตัวมันไปต้มตัวเพราะว่ามันไปตัวไปต้มว่าดาวเอารถนี่จังซั่นจังซี่แล้วบัดแล้วแล้วแม่นเพื่อเอาไปขายลาวพุ่นข้าพเจ้าเว้าถึงบ่ว่าการตัวต้มนี่แปลว่าคันดาวเอาแล้วส่งข้ามไปลาวแล้วบ่ใช้เงินดาวแม่นบ่
It's certainly not German. I know, right? That's insensitive.
I would go as far as saying that it does not sound like Turkish.
Yeah, I was leaning towards it not being Turkish as well, but the main question is, what about those other ones?
I don't think it sounds like Thai.
Okay.
So
I wouldn't have known, but so we're leaning Malay or Lao.
Hmm.
Ah. I mean, listen, I had to click on one of them. I literally went back and forth and clicked when
yeah.
I was like, it felt like I was halfway between. I had no idea which one I was clicking. I clicked the wrong one.
Happens.
I do find we're getting a lot better. So, I mean, we just did 14 questions with 3 mistakes, right? So we did 11 correct ones. Also, it was the hardest difficulty they have. And at least twice... we were very clearly saying it's one of these two and then just happened to click the wrong one.
Yeah. I mean, we're kind of lucky with the languages that we rolled.
I mean, to be fair, right? Let me quickly go back to my page. There are 92 languages in there, right? Which is a lot. But if you consider that, again, they had Norwegian, they had Swedish, they had Faroese. I don't know if they've had any other North Germanic ones, but those are North Germanic.
Yeah.
And they've had German. I'm not sure if we've seen Dutch, but they have Afrikaans and Luxembourgish, all of which I think are West Germanic languages, and English, mind you. So that's 4, right? So it's already 7 languages that are Germanic. They've had
mm-hmm.
definitely French, Italian, Spanish, Catalan. So at least, I think they had Romanian as well at some point. So 4 or 5 Romance languages at least. Also Latin. So it's at least 5 Romance languages. And it's like, already we have like 16 languages that are in families that I speak. Slavic languages, we had a variety of those.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, I wouldn't say that I speak any Slavic languages to any serious degree, but I'm trying. I'll get there. But I mean, you are, as I pointed out, a native Russian speaker, so that should be too difficult for you. The main question is if you have multiple, which one is it? And like, once we have all of those already eliminated, then, you know, you have some of the more easy ones like Japanese. You also speak enough probably to recognize it at least. Korean was relatively distinct. Yeah. There's multiple Chinese languages in there, which you can kind of usually tell at least that they are like at least East Asian languages. And once you break that stuff down, there isn't that much left of the 92, right? We can probably get about half of the languages, like, somewhat just by what it sounds like.
Yeah. I guess that's true.
Which, actually, I mean, it is still kind of interesting how much coverage we got, because I think people that... I mean, even though we don't speak that many languages between the two of us, but also just, again, some of the basic stuff. Like, I'm pretty sure most people could tell, oh, this sounds like an East Asian language, for example, for your Chinese, Japanese, Korean sort of thing. And I find that they sound distinct enough from one another, especially Chinese versus the other two, where I can pretty easily tell if it's Chinese or if it's like, if I had to decide if it's like Chinese or Japanese or Chinese or Korean or something, I would probably be able to get that right more often than not. Which, more often than not, is the high standard, but like most of the time, I would say. Which brings us to the second topic, which is good questions to ask, as per conversationsoversworld.com.
A classic.
Question 15, which is, when did something start out badly for you, but in the end it was great? I'm sure there are things. I can't come up with anything in particular. I know that when I was younger, I had the experience multiple times of like, I didn't want to do something or didn't want to go somewhere. Like, oh yeah, let's do this. It's going to be fun. Like, I don't know. And then when I went, it ended up being fun. But I just remember noticing that pattern. I don't actually remember where specifically that happened in individual cases. And even then, it only started badly in as far as my attitude started out badly, not in as far as it literally was a bad experience until it wasn't.
The only thing I can think of right now is my search for an apprenticeship. So I was like one of the latest or like last people in my class to get an apprenticeship.
Yeah.
At the end of the school year. But I did land a pretty good one. And like later on, hearing the experiences from other classmates in the apprenticeship from other companies.
Yeah.
I feel like I got a pretty good company.
I mean, I guess all of those sort of things where you have like the process at first where you have to like get to the point and then once you're there, it's good.
Mm-hmm.
You could generalize it to some degree, but I can't even think of something like that, right? Because like when I was looking about college stuff, I was like, I guess what do I want to do? I don't know. Computer science sounds like something I would be into. And then it's like, oh yeah, computer science has literally no requirements at the local university, so I'll just go there. Like, you just fill out your paperwork and congratulations, you're now in the course, right? Like, there was no effort behind it, so it's not really that difficult. I genuinely don't know.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm sure there is something, but nothing that could come up with right in the spot. How would your country change if everyone, regardless of age, could vote? I mean, yours wouldn't change much. Since it's pretty difficult to vote for the opposition anyways. I guess Germany's a more interesting question. Because we actually have free elections.
Yeah.
I know I've taken way too many shots at Russia today, but I feel like at least most of it was warranted. Oh shit! It would not change for the better, I think, because first-time voters had a tendency to vote FDP a lot, which I don't get, but okay. Whereas, so I mean, they did end up become part of the government, anyways. But if the first-time voters are an indicator, then presumably younger demographics would also more likely agree with them. So you might end up having more voters for FDP rather than the establishment parties, which is not necessarily a bad thing, but also probably fewer votes overall for the Greens. So it might have ended up being that you get just like FDP, SPD, or FDP, CDU sort of coalition rather than the SPD, FDP, Greens that we currently have. Which still was my favorite by any stretch, but...
Yeah.
I much rather... I mean, SPD and Greens I'm relatively happy with. I was just hoping we weren't going to have the FDP in there. And again, young voters would have just made that even more prevalent. Yeah.
Probably, yeah.
I mean, there were like, I think two seats short of being able to do... I think two or three seats. I think I had three seats short of being able to make SPD, Greens, and Left, which would have been one that I would have really appreciated. And then there was actually another party that was, as far as I understand it, relatively left-leaning and actually got a single seat, which makes them even closer, but not quite close enough. Which also would have been hilarious if they had been in the government, because, again, they have literally one seat. Like, you can't even just get one seat under normal circumstances. There's, actually...
Oh.
Yeah, under German law, there's the 5% hurdle, which it means that a party has to get at least 5% of the votes to get seats. There's two exceptions to that. One is if you get at least three direct nominations, which would also be three more seats. And the other one is if you represent a minority. And since that party represented a Danish minority in Germany, they got one seat, despite the fact that they only get enough votes for one seat rather than 5%, which I think is like, I don't know, like 7 or 8 seats probably.
Damn.
It's probably more than that because they have like 300 seats, right? So it would probably be like 15 seats even. I don't come to think of it.
Yeah.
Though I don't know again about... No, but the direct mandates now have to proportionally follow, so they would, yeah. I think the left actually also, the left party also got in despite not having 5%, because they had 4.9% of the vote, but they had at least, I think they had exactly three direct mandates, meaning the direct mandates are locally voted upon, so your ballot will have once the party that you want to vote for, and then once an individual candidate from your area, one per party, though not every party will run a candidate in every jurisdiction. And so, if the direct candidates are just like whomsoever gets the most points gets that seat, and the you know the second person in second place gets nothing, and then the party vote actually determines the actual distribution of the seats overall. You used to be able to get overhang seats, where if you got more direct nominations than you would have gotten seats, then you still get those seats. Now there's also new seats that they bring in to equalize that again, because otherwise it wouldn't be democratic, because some parties actually care about being democratic. Okay, I was actually trying to take a shot at the US there, but that didn't quite work. No, about like, you know, proportional representation and stuff, because the US is like notorious for like voting California only being like 2.5th of a vote in... It wasn't even Maine. I was going to say Maine, but Maine is small, but it's not population as small as... Anyways, Wyoming or something. I don't know. It doesn't matter. Right, so overhang seats, correction seats, blah, 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 it ends up being the proportions of the party list votes, but the direct mandates can make specific people get into, get seats. And so if you get three direct mandates, then you're in, the, what is it, Congress, whatever, like, it's not right, in the Bundestag, as it were. And then... No matter how many percenters you got over. I think I've heard it might have been the first time that has happened, that rule was triggered, but it definitely was. And again, the other exception was also triggered, so we had one federal election where both exceptions to the 5% hurdle were actually triggered by different parties. I mean, obviously by different parties. Otherwise, if you have one, you don't need the other. Though you could technically still meet both. I mean, I've gotten way off topic when I started this whole rant about the German political system.
A bit. Not that much.
It is! Politics is the topic. I don't think it would change that much. The main problem is, like, how young do you think people would actually turn out to vote, right? Because, like, there have been propositions to expand the voting age to 16, and I'm like, okay, sure, you know? If I had been able to vote at 16, I probably would have, and I would have probably voted very similarly to how I vote now, so
yeah.
It probably wouldn't have mattered that much. I mean, it would have mattered in as far as younger people are more well-represented, but it wouldn't have mattered in terms of, like, oh yeah, I need to mature to really get a good political taste, right? Like that. So I think in that sense, if you slightly expand, it definitely wouldn't change that much. The problem is, if, you know, five-year-olds are, realistically, they probably can't even vote on their own. So then you either have the problem where parents will influence their children to just get another vote for whomever they're voting for, which mostly just changes that people with children are overly represented, which doesn't matter all that much because I don't think there's, like, a huge variation of, like, people with children versus no children in terms of which parties they vote for. But in terms of children actually making their own decisions, I think it only matters down to a certain age. Overall, there would be an advantage of either reducing or completely... it's ridiculous to get rid of the voting age, but to reduce it would make sense, and as far as it would help new ideas be able to effectively find a foothold faster, because the current establishment basically gets aged out a little bit faster because the younger voters' block is a little bit larger overall.
Yeah. So, moving on to question 17. What animal would be the cutest if scaled down to the size of a cat? I'd say some larger cat.
I was about to say, first of all, define size of a cat, right? Like, that's a big one. But first of all, various types of cats. Second of all, what are we going by? Mass, volume, surface area, right? Like, I mean, surface area is kind of ridiculous because the more smooth you are, the less surface area you have. It's like the coastline paradox, which we talked about before. But you could still go by, like, you know, various metrics. You could go like shoulder height, which is a very common way to determine the height of an animal. But also that, like, if you walk upright, like, for example, a gorilla, you're going to have a lot higher shoulder height than if you walk on all fours, like a cat. So if you size the gorilla down to the size of a cat, that way it would be even smaller than if you did it, like, roughly by volume. Which would actually be kind of cute to come think of it. But, I think the problem is, I don't know if there's anything where it really makes a lot of sense to size down, because we're mostly talking about mammals at that point. I mean, there are some, like, aquatic animals, I guess. Because most animals, believe it or not, are smaller than cats.
True.
Like, the vast, vast majority of species are smaller than cats. Of animal species, specifically. I think plants and fungi can get pretty large. But, of animals, specifically. Because some, like a tardigrade, they're actually kind of... Okay, I mean, I think they're mostly just made cute whenever they animate them, but I think in real life they probably wouldn't be as cute. But, like, you have to way size them up rather than size them down. I'm thinking of the Target episode from Star Trek Short Treks, but I think they're not actually that cute.
I don't actually know what animal that is.
It's literally microscopic normally.
I don't know, man.
Obviously something like even something like an insect, most of them would be terrifying if they were the size of a cat. But in a way that offers very fun options that we wouldn't otherwise have. What if we size down to the size of a cat to be cute? I mean, cats are pretty damn cute already, man.
Yeah. Just pick like a slightly larger cat and scale it down by like a minuscule factor.
I mean, yeah, there's a thing where it's like, oh yeah, I find a lot of like wild cats. That's the one I'm looking for. Great cats, something like that. A lot of cats are kind of cute, and if you scale them down to the size of a house cat, they'd probably be even cuter.
Probably.
I mean, also you could go with like a lot of canines, but it's like, I think dogs wouldn't necessarily become much cuter if you size them down to the size of a cat, and the dogs that already are the size of a cat are devil spawn. I don't like chihuahuas. They're weird and creepy. I don't know.
I do agree.
Oh, dude, you know what would be really cute if it was the size of a cat? A bumblebee.
I'm concerned.
Bumblebees are cute.
But not if they're the size of a cat.
And they're furry! You can actually pet them. You shouldn't. I've been told you get stung if you do that. My mother may or may not have been speaking from experience. apparently, my mother, when she was but a child herself, once tried to pet a bumblebee. It did not go well for her. But apparently, they are really fluffy.
Mm. Yeah, no, I don't really like big insects all that much.
I mean, most of them wouldn't want either.
At all.
Bumblebees. Yeah. It's that thing where as soon as something is fat, people think it's really cute. And bumblebees just bite. I mean, because they're really fluffy, they just. I don't know. Also, by the way, the whole fat animals are cute thing.
I'd be somewhat.
Most of
okay
those
with like
are
a we're like a big bee, but that's stretching it. I don't know.
I mean, bumblebees are a lot cuter than bees. Anyways, oh dude, bear, like a grizzly bear, or like a I was gonna say or a polar bear, but
actually,
honestly, I find those less cute. But like a grizzly bear the size of a cat. I mean, I feel like every time I see a grizzly bear...
No, I'd go with a brown bear.
Or, yeah, I mean, don't even know the exact differences between those two. I mean, I know there are different, I think brown bears are already a bit smaller, but, like, whenever I see, like, a big bear, especially, again, those types, I'm always like, I kind of want to cuddle it. I mean, I don't see it in person, so not like I had the opportunity, but, like,
yeah,
I kind of want to cuddle it, but they're also, like, really dangerous. So,
yeah.
It's a forbidden fruit.
True.
Oh boy. Sergey, if your job gave you a surprise 3-day paid break to rest and recuperate, what would you do with these 3 days?
Probably sleep. A lot.
So you're saying you have a job again?
No.
That's what I was kind of getting at. First of all, like, I'm a college student, Sergey is unemployed, we don't have jobs. Second of all, yeah, I mean, just chill, do whatever I'm currently doing as a college student who, you know, doesn't really have anything to do anyways. Yeah, I mean, just, like, mostly just chill and watch TV, like, watch some YouTube videos.
Like, I don't really like to plan that stuff, like vacation for, like, only a couple of days. And like, especially if it's a surprise 3 days.
I mean, yeah, you're not gonna fly somewhere.
Can't really plan anything. Also, I like how they had to specify paid break.
Oh yeah, Americans and all that.
Mm-hmm.
I've already ragged on America today. I don't need to. okay, so we're going to do one more. What is wrong, but sounds right? Oh, wrong but sounds right. I was literally just thinking the other way around when I first heard that. What is wrong but sounds right? Most logical fallacies?
Yeah.
Like, a lot of logical fallacies, if you don't know them, are very convincing. Pretty much any statistic that is presented out of context.
Let me look if I have like a couple factoids still written down. Mm. new. Oh, no, no, actually I do. So, owls are the only birds that can see the color, color blue. Would be a thing that sounds right, but is actually wrong.
Okay, yeah, that, I mean, that sounded plausible enough, but I'm pretty sure there are birds that eat blueberries, which doesn't necessarily mean they have to see the color, but I mean, what would it, if you couldn't distinguish it, what would it most look like? And it would probably look a lot like green. In which case, the berries would have the same color as the rest of the fruit, would be very hard to spot them.
Mm.
I don't know if they are at large birds that eat them, but I would suspect they do. Like, a lot of birds eat berries. So.
Probably.
Also, there are
blue birds. But.
Like blue jays, for example. It would be kind of weird if they couldn't see the color that they are. I mean, I'm sure animals like that exist, but especially birds who oftentimes do, with like their color and their like stuff, tend to attract mates. It would be kind of weird if you couldn't see their color. Like peacocks too, right? Their male peacocks are blue, I'm pretty sure. But like the plumage is like, you know, green with like patterns on it and shit, but I think the bird itself is blue. Female peacocks I think are like brown or something, which again, the females select the male partners, thereby the males have the extravagant good colors and the like huge plumage and all that shit. Why would they be blue if the females couldn't see the color blue? I mean, I'm not saying that you're wrong to point this out, that is something that that is wrong but sounds right. But the fact of the matter is, if you think about it enough, it actually also starts sounding wrong. But you have to really think about it. If someone just says it, bulls cannot. No, okay, what is wrong? Bulls are aggressive to the color red. It's wrong. But a lot of people think it's right because it's just so commonly cited, when in fact they cannot even distinguish the color red, and it is actually about the movement more so than about the color. So also the whole thing about seeing red, I think, is might be derived from that. I'm not 100% sure. Would then also be based on a falsehood. Oh, also the whole alpha beta thing.
I mean, depends on the context, I think, in which you use seeing red.
Becoming angry.
That might be, because I think that might also be used to mean like having losses, probably financial.
Oh, that is being in the red.
Ah, okay.
Because of the red numbers that are sometimes used for loss. Heard a funny story once about someone where they were like really concerned about all the savings all of a sudden because they were all red and turned out they just didn't have any black ink anymore. But that's besides the point. I think that a lot of the common misconceptions, really, I think, like the bulls are a great example, of course, but I mean, anything that's a common misconception, most of them sound right because you're just so used to hearing it, right? Carrots improve eyesight, like, no, they don't, right? You just think that. It's British war propaganda because they didn't want to give away the fact that they had night vision. I think that's the fact behind it.
Wasn't that radar? I think it was radar.
It could have been radar. It doesn't matter. Point is, it's British propaganda, and that's just not true.
Yeah.
A lot of those sort of smaller things that people, oftentimes a lot of people do believe, but is actually not true, thereby clearly sounds right enough for people to believe it, but it's actually wrong. So I guess very broadly, it's just common misconceptions and logical fallacies. But in more detail, I thought I had another one, but I can't come up with it right now. But again, it would have just been another misconception anyway, so it's not that novel of an idea. What is wrong but sounds right? The fact that this show is going to keep going on forever. No. In fact, I think we're coming very close to the end, but before we go, we do have songs of the week. So, yay!
Mm-hmm.
What's song of the week?
My song of the week is Our Way by G2 Esports.
That's not bad. I mean,
it was kind of weird to select the 22nd segment out of it.
Okay.
Because they do stretch the lines a bit. At least it felt that way.
Yeah, this is one of those where I have a very similar opinion to what I said last week, where it's like, oh yeah, it sounds good, but also I definitely have to listen to this again to make if I like actually like it, or if it's just like one of those that is like okay, but I wouldn't necessarily listen to it like intentionally. Okay, that sounds mm-hmm. unnecessarily harsh, but you know what I mean. I wouldn't go out of my way to make up or something.
Yeah.
That sort of thing. My song of the week, I'm just gonna guess, is older. Because I'm gonna guess this is a relatively recent song.
It's been released this year.
Oh yeah. My song is definitely older. and that is The Wanderer by Dion.
Nice.
I mean, it's from the 60s, so it's quite a bit older than a song from today.
Yeah.
Oh my God, wait. Now I want to know which exact year it's from, actually. The Wanderer. Do I have to put the on song, or does it know that by itself? It does not. Books, film, television, music. Pop songs. The Wanderer by Dion. 1961. It's over 60 years older than your song.
Damn.
Which in of itself
that's
just sounds kind
of
crazy.
A lot of years.
This song is over 60 years old. Wow.
Damn.
Hey. I was just going to look up. Dion was born in 1939 and is now 82. I was like, well, I mean, if I do my math right, that means he would have been 22 when the song came out. Which, first of all, impressive, but second of all, I was gonna say, chances are, the guy who sang it is probably dead by now, but no, turns out, you know, he's like 82, it's not even like that old. I mean,
he's
82 is relatively old.
Alive and chilling. Yeah.
Oh, speaking of alive and chilling, do you want to do one thing before we go out of here?
Yes. I was waiting for you to mention that the whole time. And if you weren't, I was going to talk to you about it after the podcast. He's still alive.
Ever? Since I looked that up, right, the stat about like oldest living people, like over a year ago at this point for sure. It's always been Kana Tanaka, and I'm pretty sure it's also always been Lucille Rondon in second place. I'm not 100% sure about Antonia de Santa Cruz in third place, but hey, this
impressive.
Seems like a position with high turnover.
Yeah.
But I guess ever since I became aware of them, they just can't die, I guess. I don't know. That's not how that works. Listen, right? I'm not saying they should or anything. It just seems interesting that they haven't, is all I'm saying. It's been a while.
Yeah. Also quite impressive, to be honest.
Yeah. Dude. Kana Tanaka turned 119 like 3 weeks ago, you know?
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty impressive. I'm pretty sure I put her very high on the all-time list as well.
I would guess so, yeah.
I think she was like... she is currently in third place. And Lucille Rondon is in fourth place. I don't know why. There it is. That's the same article. It's just a little bit further up. Like, there they are. Third or fourth place?
That is... quite impressive.
It's just like... 80 more days until Kantanaka's officially in second place. Whoops, I didn't mean to do that. And, well, I mean, after that, there's like a 3-year gap, so that's going to take a while, but about 3 years, as a matter of fact. Math, am I right? But this has nothing to do with any of our segments. This is just us keeping up with the oldest people in the world. I still can't get over the fact that ever since I first looked at that list, they just haven't changed. I mean, at least the top two. Again, I can't remember the full list.
Yeah. I mean, you could probably look it up with the history.
I mean, yeah. I can't
thingy see on.
You can look up a bunch of stats. Like, I mean, what is it? Kana Tanaka has been the oldest living person since the 22nd of July, 2018.
Yeah, that's been a long while.
3 years and 182 days, as of recording. The previous record holder held it for 92 days. Oh yeah, I think I pointed out before, like how long you have to, how far you have to go back to get like over a year, over 2 years, over 3 years. It's gonna take a while, man. Oh yeah, Jean Calment was literally the last one to hold it for over 2 years. Oh, no, for over 3 years, sorry. There was one in between with over two. Yeah, she's literally the only person on this list that has... the most recent person that has held it longer than Kana Tanaka. And she's the oldest verified person living ever. So, she held it for 9 years and 205 days. And she, of course, died at the age of 122 and, like, over half. None of which has anything to do with this topic, the topics of today. So, I think it is time for me to say like, comment, and subscribe. Until next time, Sergey.
That's it.
That's it.